Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 6, Knowledge Graphs. In this section of the lecture, we are going to talk about the semantic web and the web of data. Okay, first let's recapitulate the web, the World Wide Web that we all know. So what's the basic architecture of the web? First of all, you need to identify things on the web. What are the things you identify on the web? So usually it's documents, it's HTML documents or something like that. And for identification, what we are using are so-called URIs or address identifiers, URLs. So URIs are uniform resource identifier and URLs are uniform resource locators. We will talk later about the difference between identifier and locator. But the URL or URI are the basic means of identification and reference in the web. What else do we have? We have to access, of course, these kind of documents. And for that, we have a transportation protocol or communication protocol. And this is HTTP, the Hypertext Transfer Protocol. You for sure have heard that. With that, you can access a website. You ask a server, it's a client server based system, the web, via HTTP. You have a HTTP request, and the answer then is the HTML code that will be transferred from the server that you have accessed. And the way how you encode your documents, so the representation language of the web, this is HTML, the hypertext markup language. So I could there work, for example, that Mary works at KIT, and I can link KIT with the web address of KIT. You all have seen this. And all these three, they make up the basic architecture of the web. Thanks a lot to my colleague Fabien Gandon, who has provided these nice graphics. Okay, but we want to go a step further. Based on the web, today there is the web of data. So there are not only documents linked with each other, there are huge collections of data set. And many of them are linked to each other and they form the so-called web of data. So the web of data is kind of an upgrade of the traditional web of documents. And it's the web as a huge decentralized database or knowledge base, if you are using then semantic web languages, for example, to denote the meaning, the semantics of exactly these documents and data sets. And the point is, all of these data sets are machine accessible. This is not, let's say, something new, but of course, this vision is around for a long time, already more than 20 years ago. Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the web, he stated in 1998, the web of human readable documents is being merged with the web of machine understandable data. The potential of the mixture of humans and machines working together and communication through the web could be immense. And this is what's going to happen. We have machine understandable data and we have human readable documents. And of course, they are matched. What is possible with that? It's a new kind of information system that arises there. So you probably then in a future web don't have, let's say, fixed HTML pages that somebody offers and you access. You have lots of data sources in the web and you have probably a personal assistant somewhere on your personal computer. So it's residing, let's say, in your browser. And this personal assistant is using and guiding, managing intelligent infrastructure services that are harvesting the data that is somewhere distributed and provided over the web. And then, of course, according to your needs, this personal assistant creates something like a virtual HTML page locally on your computer by aggregating all of the data that is necessary to fulfill your personal information needs according to your personal preferences. So this is the vision of the web of data. In the semantic web itself, which is an extension of the current web, you are using ontologies or knowledge representations to make the meaning of things really clear. So the meaning of information, the semantics, is made explicit by formal, structured, and standardized knowledge representations, so via ontologies. By that, it will then be possible to process the meaning of information in an automated way, so with the help of computer programs, and to relate and integrate heterogeneous data also in an automated way, which is really, really a good and efficient way. That is not possible always today if you are using, let's say, structured databases, relational databases, object-related databases, or whatever. The point is you always have to write mappers and have to invest manual effort to combine one, let's say, table with another table, one database with another database. In the semantic web, in case the meaning of the single fields that you are representing there is semantically accessible, machine understandable, then it's also possible to find an automated mapping between two fields. So therefore, data integration will be made much, much easier. And as a second thing or a third thing, what you will be able to deduce implicit, so not evident, information from existing information in an automated way by simply leveraging this possibility of logical inferences that we have seen in the last section of the lecture. So thereby, the semantic web is a kind of global database that contains a universal network of semantic propositions. Now, the question is, how is this really implemented? And for the implementation of the semantic web, there exists a huge architecture. So there is a technology stack, which is usually referred to as the semantic web technology stack. And these technologies are standardized by the W3C, which is the World Wide Web Consortium, which also has standardized HTML, HTTP, and the other web protocols. So this technology stack has evolved and developed over time. So previously it was much smaller. It was simply, you know, a slice of a pie. And now you see it has become much more complex. But don't worry about that. So we will go step by step through the important points here in the technology step, and you will learn how to deal with these things. So we start on the very basic level, which is the web platform that we are dealing with. Okay. Looking here at the web platform, what you see here are the common web technologies that are of our interest. So for example, if I want to identify something like the Mount Everest down here, I'm of course use a URI. So I need a uniform resource identifier to identify something. And since I do not only want to make assumptions and statements about web documents, of course I need a reference of a thing in the real world somewhere in the web. Therefore, I have to identify it. And this usually is then a URI, a Uniform Resource Identifier. It's a web address for a real thing. So Mount Everest could be referred to by, for example, this is the information page or reference page of Mount Everest in a huge global knowledge base, which has the name DBpedia, and this has been extracted from Wikipedia. However, I could also use another knowledge base like Wikidata. Probably you have already heard of Wikidata. So this is also part of the Wikimedia universe, like Wikipedia is a universal encyclopedia. Wikidata is a universal database where you can put in and describe things via structured data. However, there is also a semantic web like, let's say, interface, and this we are also going to use rather often here in the lecture. However, to the web platform, not only here the URI to identify things is used, also let's say HTTP as the standard web access and communication protocol is used, and all of the authorization mechanisms that you already know. So we are based on the traditional web platform. Now, to encode information, the semantic web technology stack is using RDF, which is the resource description framework. And this is a rather, let's say, simplistic way to encode information, because everything, every fact you want to state is broken down into so-called triples. What's a triple? A triple consists like a rather simple sentence in natural language of subject, predicate, and object. Only thing in semantic web, you don't call it predicate, you call it property. This comes from logics, and in logics you are distinguishing predicates and properties, since also there these terms are ambiguously used. So we simply keep in mind a statement can be expressed by a subject, a property, and an object. And what is this? So you say something about a subject, this is your entity about you say something, and then you have, let's say, something like an attribute, which means you have a property name plus a property value, which is then the property and the object you're talking about. And either, you know, this object is a value, which means if I give a birth date of a person, if I give the height of Mount Everest, I give, of course, then a number or a date. Or it can be also another individual, or it can be a class. Like here, for example, I say that Mount Everest is of type mountain. So you see here lots of these colons. What we are dealing with here in general, everything here, every part of a sentence like this of a small triple is a URI. And since it's way too long to write also these absolute URIs, you are using relative URIs. So these are abbreviations that you see here, and you will later learn how to abbreviate these kind of URIs. So you see here some definitions about Mount Everest written in the resource description framework. Like, for example, Mount Everest is a mountain. It has the name Mount Everest. It has an elevation of 8,848. It's named after George Everest, who is a person and who was born in 1790. Okay, but this is, of course, only statements about individuals. You want to build also a terminological structure, so the T-box that we have already seen. How does that work? So therefore, we need another layer. So to construct models, we have another modeling layer where we have several languages, starting with RDFS, which is the RDF schema language, or OWL, which is the web ontology language. So here I can define classes, I can define relations among classes and stuff like that. What I have here in terms of a graph, I can also here write in RDF schema. And this again is expressed based on RDF. So everything again, also on this level, you will see triples and triple notation. So what we say here is a mountain is a class. A mountain is a subclass of a landform. An elevation is a property which connects something. So it has the domain something with the range of an integer. So elevation always here is defined as an integer. You could also define it as a float. It doesn't matter. So this is only, you know, a question of how to model it. And you say named after is also a property which has the domain thing. So anything can be named after somebody. However, named after, if it's named after somebody, then the range of this property should be a person. So this is, for example, RDF schema. With that, I'm only able to do rather, let's say, simple modeling tasks. If I want to model more sophisticated or complicated stuff where I need more semantic expressivity, I have to take, for example, OWL, or I have to use more complex, more expressive logic, like, for example, rules I have to use. So what I can say here, for example, Mount Everest is named after George Everest, and I can define George Everest is, since he was born in 1790, he's in the class that I define here of dead people. What are dead people? I can define this class here based on a rule where I say, for example, so for all X, there exists a Y, where, so meaning that, you know, if person X, X is a person here, has a death date Y and Y is a date, then X comes to the class or is in the class dead people, which means everybody who has a death date usually is referred to as being dead. And as we know, dead people, I can define then also another class, a contradictory class, living people. Usually then the intersection of both is empty, which means these are disjoint classes, both subclasses of person. If I want to define something like that, I do this in OWL. And OWL again is triple based, so there is again a triple based notation of OWL. However, with the rules, then it's getting a bit more complicated because then we are entering also the realm of more complex logics. However, there is also a way to express that, but this is then beyond what we are doing in this small course about knowledge graphs. Okay, so this more or less is how I can represent knowledge. However, the technology stack also gives me the possibility to query this knowledge and to query these knowledge bases. So there is a powerful query language, which is called Sparkle. Sparkle is like SQL. You might have heard of SQL for relational databases or object-related databases. So this is a rather powerful and well-known language for databases, and Sparkle is pretty similar, as you see here. And there you can then query a huge knowledge base. So here, for example, we are querying the knowledge base DBpedia. We want to list all mountains and the people who died there, ordered by the number of deaths. So I have always provided here links that if you click on that, then automatically you will be transferred here to DBpedia and to a query interface. This is the Sparkle endpoint, and then you can execute that kind of query and you see you get a result, which is a table, and you see here the Mount Everest where 18 people have died, Ischia seems to be a mountain, I don't know, where 7 people have died, Nanga Parbat where 6 people have died, and so on and so on. Okay, to show you that this is also possible in another knowledge base, we have previously also referred to Wikidata. This is the same query, now not on DBpedia, but on Wikidata. So also there, you can follow the link and quickly come to the Wikidata query service where we have here directly imported the query. And then what you do is simply you execute the query by pressing here the play button. And this takes a while. Wikidata is rather large. And then this query here, selecting all of the mountains and people who died on the mountains, is carried out. And you see here, we want to display it in a timeline-based fashion. So you can then here explore the timeline of people we have extracted here to see who has died on a specific mountain. So to see the detail here also in the presentation, so this is the timeline, a bit enlarged, that we have extracted from there. And there you see probably that obviously a philosopher called Empedocles died on Mount Etna in the year 430 BCE. Okay, this was a very quick introduction into the semantic web architecture. In the next section of the lecture, we are going to talk about linked data and the linked data principles, which are essential to construct the web of data.